The second couple of sessions of the morning. So we will start with Matheus Grasselli, who is, as you know, an excellent researcher, a very good friend, and a very well-known entertainer. Yeah, it's always a pleasure. He could read a phone book. I would still love to attend it. Yeah. So he's going to talk about the master equation. Does the name come from the McMaster University?
No.
No. Okay. No.
Copyrighted before.
Okay.
That, yeah.
It's not the McMaster equation. No. Okay. So I think you more than deserve the stage. So welcome.
Thank you, Bruno, and thank you, Jorge, and the other organizers. It's always great to be back in Rio. This is the first year in one of these conferences that I didn't give a mini course, and I like to use my mini courses as just a three-hour extended introduction to my talk. So now I cannot have that, so I need to do the introduction here. So, well, let's see how fast I can do it. So it's as you see in the title, it's a talk about macroeconomics, but with a different type of modeling. And the master equation, as Bruno mentioned. So I thought I would start with a brief intro to macroeconomics. Before I put that there, I'm always reminded of there's a guy who he's an economist, but he's also a stand-up comedian. So he calls himself the stand-up economist. You should Google him. It's absolutely hilarious. And at the beginning of his act, he defines the difference between microeconomics and macroeconomics, and by saying that microeconomists are people who like to be wrong about specific things, whereas macroeconomists just like to be wrong in general. So that's what we're going to be doing here. So a brief history of macro following the sort of a mainstream evolution of macroeconomics. Of course, in the beginning, there was no distinction between micro and macro. It was just economics, as you can imagine. And if you read, and I'm spending part of my sabbatical reading back this old text, because they're extremely informative. If you read Adam Smith and David Ricardo Marx, they talk about things that we would now call micro and macro interchangeably, but the emphasis is on the long-run stage of the economy. There's something that always holds, which is Say's law, so it means that whatever is produced is consumed, so it's the famous supply creates its own demand. But then this started to be challenged at the beginning of the 20th century, Wichsel, Fisher, and that's where the concepts like the natural rate of interest, and that still permeates the debate today. You read Paul Krugman, who say the natural rate of interest is too low or is too high, and it's kind of a mysterious thing. Nobody can measure, nobody knows what it is, but it's part of the discourse. Fisher was the guy who created the debt deflation concept that we might or might not mention today, but it's the idea that if you are in a recessionary state, you try to pay down your debts, but if everybody tries to pay down their debts, then there's not enough money to go around, then there's a contraction of the economy as a whole, and then the debt that you're trying to pay looks even bigger than when you started paying. So that's the spiral that leads you to a recession. And then Keynes, it's call a revolution, and for a good reason. He challenged many of these classic ideas. He was the first person who started looking systematically at something that I just mentioned, that something that is done by one agent, when you aggregate many agents doing the same thing, it might not lead to the same result that you would obtain if you just have one agent, so the fallacy of composition. Role of expectations, but in a much more fundamental way than later became, the rational expectation hypothesis, and really, I'm not doing justice to Keynes at all. You just need to go and read a lot of what he wrote. But that was a dividing point, and to many, it was the start of modern macroeconomics, only to be then. repackaged in the 40s and 50s by people like Paul Samuelson, who then look, okay, well, maybe what Keynes was doing, he called it the general theory, but it was not so general. It only applies to crisis and recession states. But in general, we are always close to an equilibrium where the classical ideas hold, and then all that we need is to stir back the economy to the proximity of the equilibrium by things like government intervention. And so you do that, so you put that as an ad hoc addition to the overall framework, and then everything works again. So this was called the neoclassical synthesis, and for a while it looked like the entire planet was Keynesian. They could control aggregate demand by doing fine-tuning of the movements of the economy. And then all hell broke loose in the 70s with things like stagflation, where the expected trade-offs that Keynesians were, by that point, used to be doing didn't work anymore. And then this is a counter-revolution, so against the Keynesian revolution, this was the rational expectations revolution. And essential to that was the point that the agents that are in your model need to be just as capable as doing the calculations as the person doing the modeling. And therefore, you cannot sort of fool the agents, so to speak, with policies that they don't understand. They just follow what the policy is without understanding the consequences. So this is the Lucas critique, that the agents need to be as rational as the modeler. And then, as a proof of concept, they developed models where this was possible, and these are the models where rational expectations hold. And then they would find things like the measures to stimulate the economy by having inflation would not work because the agents would anticipate what inflation would be and things like that. So they were vindicated by the stagflation and completely sort of rewrote the map of academic macroeconomics. The only problem is that, yes, and then in particular, it started a kind of a divide, mostly in the United States, between what's called freshwater macro and saltwater macro. This has to do with where the universities are located. The saltwater macro people are close to the coast, and they tend to be less dogmatic about the purity of this rational expectations paradigm, whereas the people associated with universities near lakes like Chicago and Minnesota, they take a more fundamental point of view. So this is called the real business cycles, where you know, even large fluctuations in aggregate activity are explained by real supply things. So the word real, that means that it has to do with technology, it has to do with productivity, it has to do with something that is not about weird aggregation phenomena. And the aggregation phenomena play a secondary role. It's for the time being, people are confused about the uses of technology. Someone invents an iPad and you don't really know what to do, so there's a shock. But by the time that people adjust to this shock, then everything converges back to equilibrium. And this was gave the impression that everybody was agreeing when this got formalized through something called dynamic stochastic general equilibrium models. And that impression persisted until the financial crisis. In fact, Olivier Blanchard, who then became a chief economist of the IMF, had a major speech in 2008, so a few months before the financial crisis, where he tried to explain the state of macro, and the opening sentence was, the state of macro is good. And then he continued explaining why, you know, management of recessions was a well-understood phenomenon, and all the economists basically disagreed on details of how long this adjustment to information would take, but the equilibrium would always be realized. By contrast, the current chief economist of the IMF is a guy called Paul Romer, and he is much more critical. He just released this year a paper called The Trouble with Macro. So right from the start, you know that he's not going to take the point of view that the state of macro is good. So I recommend that you go read the paper and compare the views that Blanchard had then. You can even see the views that Blanchard has now. You know, he has adjusted some of his views, but not very much, with what Paul Romer has to say. Now, if I manage. These are the things that dynamic stochastic general equilibrium models assume. It's a model for, as I said, full rational expectations. It has to be based on microeconomic foundations, so nothing can be ad hoc. Nothing can be just added to the model just at a level that cannot be derived from first principles from what the economic agents are doing. Everything is in equilibrium, and perturbations of equilibrium are given by new information, but then they get restored to equilibrium. And there's neutrality of money, so the things that Keynesians would worry about, increasing the money supply, decreasing the money supply, and what they had to do with real economic activity, this theory says it does nothing. It just changes the absolute price level. You double the money supply, and you have twice, you double prices, basically. But the number of bananas that you can buy with Apple computers remains the same. So relative prices do not change. But you know, that's not quite all well. So I generated that meme in meme generators, and now some people have been copying that. But I have the copyright of that. Okay. So what if I told you that aggregate demand can be any polynomial? So this is the content of the Sonnenschein-Mantel de Brou theorem. So as a result, in general equilibrium, which ought to be the basis for dynamic stochastic general equilibrium, I mean, it has general equilibrium in the title. And what they basically show is that something that is necessary for stability of the equilibrium is not there, which is a downward slope in demand curve. So that, you know, if prices increase, you buy less of the thing, and then the prices will go back to equilibrium. And if prices decrease, you buy more, and things will go back to equilibrium. In not in practice, in general equilibrium models, let alone practice, it's known that you can have an upward slope in demand curve, even if all your agents are individually very well behaved. So it's a problem of aggregation. So if you have to remember anything, just remember that aggregating well-behaved individual economic agents does not imply a well-behaved aggregate demand function. Okay. In particular, these models have a great deal of trouble introducing finance and banking, because if everything is in equilibrium and optimally allocated and with perfect foresight, so for one thing, financial crises would never happen, and if they do happen, they're optimal financial crises, by the way. You even have trouble understanding banks, why people don't directly invest into projects that if they can correctly assess the potential outcome of the project. So why don't we just pull our resources and invest in Petrobras if we know exactly what's going to happen in the future in terms of expectations and so on and so forth. So the typical way to do that is through what's called financial friction. So because there are some constraints on agents or some costs, intermediation costs, and so on and so forth, banks arises from that. But it's a kind of upside down world where now this the whole apparatus of finance, which, as we'll mention soon, ought to play a more fundamental role in the theory, becomes just explained from some afterthought friction. You first solve the model without the frictions, and then you perturb a little bit, and then you have this multi-trillion dollar industry. So I don't find that too appealing. These are just quotes from Adair Turner showing that even in this literature of frictions, so what they can get is some sort of qualitative behavior that matches more or less what happens in reality, but it's kind of forcing through the model to have the correct quantitative behavior, and you cannot. Because then the sizes of the fluctuations that have to be impacted by the frictions are way too large to begin with. So you have, for example, to explain a financial crisis, you would have to have very large real volatility in production factors that nobody sees before the financial crisis. So it's a complicated quantitative agreement for this the people following this friction literature. And here is the slide where he says that, in the entire literature for banking as intermediation, banking is just something that takes money from households and then redirects it to the productive sector. So households are savers, the productive sector are borrowers, and then there's this intermediation because of the financial frictions. And he says that, at least in the United Kingdom, this accounts for about 15% of banking activity. So you have to explain the rest of the 85% of the activity that has nothing to do with intermediating between savers and borrowers. Very well. Then you have, so this was the traditional macro. Now, an alternative path to macro is one in which, from the beginning, financial transactions play a more important role. And it realizes that every transaction that you do, it's never just a match of two people that want to trade something. It always goes through somebody that extends some credit for you to buy that thing that you want, and then you repay later. So there is this much more fundamental role for the availability of credit and how much it's going to contract, how much it's going to be extended, and so on. So this is an alternative to both the Keynesian and the real business cycles theory. And what's important, I mean, you don't need to read all the things, but what is important is that financial intermediation is always there, transaction by transaction, is never forgotten, never put under the rug, and then dealt with when you have to explain some irregularity. And this, of course, had a huge revival after the crisis. The number of papers in this area has increased. It's not dominant yet, but it's much more significant. So what are the key insights from this literature? As I mentioned before, the money is not neutral. It's not something that you just affect the absolute price level. Money is fundamental. And moreover, there's no such a thing as one type of money. In general equilibrium models, everything can be discounted to any numerator, and they're just as equal as any other. Now, in this type of theory, there are different classes of money, and what differentiates them is who deals with that type of money. So you have security dealers that have deposits in banks, and then the banks have deposits with the central bank, so there's a whole hierarchy, and at each step of the hierarchy, there's a different role for what's called money. Then, of course, what that picture shows is that when things are very, when there's an expansion of balance sheets for everybody across the economy, the different types of money, they look alike. Because it's very easy to exchange one from the other. But as soon as there is a contraction, that's shown in the vertical axis, you immediately see differentiation between the types of money. Try to exchange your securities for deposits in the banks, and you see how hard it is. And try to exchange your deposits from deposits in the central bank, and you see how hard it is. Only the very good banks can do that. And then you go to the international level, and it's just the same story. The second is that money is endogenous. It's created inside the system by an expansion of both assets and liabilities of financial institutions. So financial institutions are not passive recipients of deposits that they channel to borrowers, but they are they create the ability for people to borrow money that was not there to begin with. Perry Merlin says in his book that one of the difficulties of explaining banks is that you have this picture in your mind that in order to lend bicycles, you need to have bicycles. Somebody put bicycles in your bicycle shop, and then somebody else comes and takes the bicycle. But the banks don't have the money that needs to be lent to begin with. They create the money in the process of lending. That's a very fundamental and counterintuitive, but nevertheless, it's how it's done in practice, so you need to wrap your head around it. And the third one is that private debt is important. In models in which there's only intermediation, then one person's asset is another person's liability, and this all washes up. But in models where there is endogenous money creation, it's important who is creating, because there's the whole hierarchy and where it's going to be put to. And so this is just showing the evolution of the employment rate and the change in private debt, and you see a very strong correlation between them. And the fourth one, and this is going to be the end of the introduction, I think, is that finance is, as Dilip Madan would say, is the sector of the economy that dictates the pace of the real economic activity. So because things are not risk neutral, because there are contracts that are not fulfilled, because the markets are incomplete, these are all synonymous, instead of having a half plane of possible trades, you have a cone of possible trades, and the aperture of the cone is given by the risk appetite of the financial sector. So that already from the start tells what kinds of projects are going to be made or not, not as an afterthought, now let's look for the money to do this. No, you look for the money first, and then you do something. So the alternative is to consider, as I mentioned before, things that, so these are called stock flow consistent models. The naming is unfortunate because it's very easy to have something that is consistent. The idea here is that it's a stock flow driven. So in other words, you not only keep track of the amounts that you have in the balance sheets of the different agents, but those amounts matter for the decisions of the agents, as opposed to general equilibrium, where the only thing that will matter is your utility function and your discount expected cash flows, not counting what is your current position into different assets, because they are all substitutes anyways. So I've been talking about stock flow consistent models for a while. I gave a couple of talks in this venue, and you will remember, I hope, that at the core is this relationship between sectors. So sectors trade with each other, and they have to have some consistency in the transactions, and then the flip side of a real transaction is the financial flow that accompanies that transaction. So those are the typical tables that you would see. However, it is a very top type of model. You only look at, you know, aggregate behaviors of sectors. So it leaves you with some dissatisfaction, that you're not really looking. Suppose that you have some insight about differences in the behavior of firms, differences in the behavior of agents. How do you put that in the model? It's not that easy if you're just dealing with sectoral averages. It ignores the distribution. You only look at the average. You can go a long way, and I like that type of model, and I've been writing papers on it, but it always leaves you with some sour taste, in aftertaste, that you ought to be looking more about individual decisions. Okay. Well, the alternative is to do agent-based models. In agent-based models, you also don't have to have equilibrium to start with. You don't have to have maximizing agents. You can have agents that have whatever rules they think are plausible. And then you just see the emergent properties of these models. But the emergent properties, they just emerge after you run it. It's very hard to anticipate. And part of the flavor of the models is that you shouldn't be able to anticipate. Because if you really believe that emergent phenomena are playing an important role, then you want to see it. You want to see it emerge. But again, that leaves you dissatisfied for a different reason. I always remember Chris saying that, you know, you just press a button and then you see the result. It's not really what we want to be doing, especially as mathematicians. Might be good for agent-based economists, and there's a whole literature that is dedicated to that. But you want to do something in between. So that's the point of this talk, so to speak. Eventually, I would like a model that has the two scales operating simultaneously. Agents that are operating on a very fast scale with rules of thumb and sort of thermalizing their behavior, and that creates the interactions for the sectors. But then they observe the time evolution of what the sectors are doing in order to make their decisions. But this is hard. It's easy to explain in words what you want to do, but to make a model that has all those elements is hard. So my compromise, I want to merge the scales and come somewhere in the middle. The compromise for this talk is to start in the middle. So I'm going to have, from the beginning, a different way of aggregating agents that it's already at a mesoscopic scale, so to speak, between the very top level of sectors and the bottom level of agents. So that's what I call mesoscopic aggregation. And so the heterogeneity here is not individual by individual, but we're going to be grouping them into classes. And it turns out that you can already encapsulate a lot of the differences in behavior in having very simple classes. I'm always reminded of the joke that says that there are three types of mathematicians, those who can count and those who can't. Now, there's an updated version of this joke that I learned recently, that there are two types of people, those who can infer from missing data. So that's what we're going to be doing here. We're going to be dividing people in classes, and it will turn out to generate enough fluctuation that it already looks like the type of fluctuations that you see in the market. Because what I didn't mention is that the models that I was dealing with before, this sort of aggregate dynamical system models, we were doing just the deterministic version. I got a lot of mileage from the deterministic version because it captures the sort of big stylized trends in the economy. But people always complain, you know, that's not the time series that you see. So one alternative is to put some ad hoc noise to that, like it's done in general equilibrium, dynamic, stochastic general equilibrium. You have the deterministic one, and then you shock it from time to time. I don't find that very satisfying either. This is an exogenous noise that you don't explain by anything that is happening in the economy. Here we're going to have the noise as the difference between the classes that people belong to. And just some simple transition from one class to another is going to be enough to generate the type of macroeconomic fluctuation that is observed in practice. So very well. So here's the some of the mathematics behind. As you all know, with the Markov process, it just follows from the Komogoro-Chapman equation. You can have this differential couple nonlinear differential equations for the probability density of the different states in your Markov chain, so to speak. And what it is you just summon all the probabilities of getting into a state minus the probabilities of getting out of the state. So it's a kind of inflow-outflow balance equation. And it's sordidly complicated if you're going to do it in general, for a general Markov chain. So of course, we're going to introduce simplifications. In particular, there's going to be a sort of a nearest neighbor. The only thing that you can do is jump up or jump down. And if the only thing you can do is jump up or down, then your equation simplifies, because now all you have to keep track of is the birth probability, so coming from a neighboring stage into you, and the death probability, going from that stage to the two neighboring states. And what are they going to be, the states? The occupation number of a given class. So if I have two classes, and if an individual jumped from there to there, then the number of individuals in this class goes down by one, the number of individuals in that class goes up by one. I could have more classes and still work like that, but it's going to make more complicated. You see that the canonical example that I'm going to be dealing with is just two classes with a fixed number of agents, and then you can only have one state variable, which is the occupation of one of the classes. Then there's a trick to come up with a semi-analytic solution of the master equation due to Aoki, a Japanese macroeconomist. Well, I guess it's found in other parts of mathematics, but he was the one to do that in macroeconomics, which is first to homogenize the equation by looking at these operators that now on the right-hand side of the equation, you only have the P X. There's no px plus 1 or px minus 1, because of course the operators are the shift operators. You go from x to x plus 1 and from x to x minus 1. But then what you do is to expand the shift operators into differential operators, so there's going to be a continuous approximation. And now you use this, then you do a little bit more, so here's a bit of the contribution of the method that, the actual number, you expect it to be some trend that scales linearly with the number of agents that you have, plus some fluctuation. And the fluctuation scales with the square root of n. And there are several ways to justify this in specific models. So now what you have to do is to come up with a time evolution for the trend and a time evolution for the distribution of the stochastic fluctuation. So this is now, instead of writing the equation for the entire density of the Markov chain, you write the equation for the only the density of the spread, and use the operators that we just introduced, rewrite the birth and death operators like this. You notice the transition rates for each individual, and you'll notice that we are in there introducing the hypothesis that the individuals are independent. So that if you have n people in class one and each has a probability mu of migration, then the total probability is mu times n. And the method generalizes, and this is a follow-up paper, if you have in addition to that a global factor, and this global factor is going to depend on how advantageous it is to belong to a class. So here you have the sort of genetic predisposition of turning from one class to another, that's the mu and the lambda, and independent agents that we're going to be taking that decision. But they can all be looking at some expected gain from belonging to one class. For example, we're going to see the classes are going to be investors and non-investors. And if investors are making a lot of money, then you can have some adaptive way of looking at the expected gains and then modifying the transition probabilities in that way. And the method generalizes well to that as well. Very well, and then after you do the expansion and collect terms, so this is, standard fare, you obtain that all that you have to keep track with, it's this ordinary differential equation for the deterministic train, and this partial differential equation for the density, which is nothing but the Fokker-Planck equation for this process. And in particular, this has a stationary solution, which you then, do your partial integration by parts there, and you find that the stationary solution looks Gaussian in the limit with a given variance, and now the variance has something to do with the transition probability. So nothing mysterious, except that this is the only thing that we need to keep track from now on. If you accept that the randomness of the system has to do with transitions of agents from one class to another. So now let's look at specific models for that. So one model was proposed by a Brazilian economist, Laura de Carvalho. Some of you might recognize her name. She writes for the Folha de São Paulo, and it's quite popular now because of the impeachment procedures and so on. And an Italian economist who works in Sydney. And I met Corrado, and he introduced me to the model, and that's how I got started in this strain of the literature. So here's a model where it's an aggregate household, an aggregate banking sector, but two classes of firms. And the firms can be aggressive or conservative. And aggressive firms invest more as a proportion of their profits than conservative firms. And so this is how they change. There's an alpha coefficient telling you how much you're going to invest as a function of pi, which is the profitability, and the total outcome. And then you get penalized by the debt, but this is assumed to be the same for both types of firms. So the only difference is in what proportion of profits, what sensitivity to profits each of these classes has. And then we do the simplest model that you can have, a price that is just a markup over cost. Here's how capital evolves for each individual firm. So the notation here is that if you see a J in there, I'm doing the agent-based version of the model. Once you evolve capital for individual firms, you evolve capital for the economy as a whole. So now you need to know what is the aggregate distribution of demand. So because demand now has two components, it's the consumption of the homogeneous household sector plus the investment of all of these firms. We make a standard assumption that consumption is a fraction of income, and plus some coefficient to do with the wealth. So there's some saving propensities. I think they're here. That's the saving propensity in income. That's the saving propensity in wealth. That's consumption. You plug it back to the formula for Q, which is consumption plus investment, and then you solve for Q. So this is the total aggregate demand. Once you know aggregate demand, now you need, because it's still a semi-aggregate model. I'm not keeping track of which households are consuming from which firms. This would be a network model. But now we make a kind of a preferential attachment for this demand. There is a whole level of aggregate demand, and we're going to assume that firms that have more capital, they take a larger chunk of aggregate demand. So, because if they have more capital, they have more market power, they have more stores on the street, they spend more in advertising, and so on and so forth. So that's the assumption for how, once computed, aggregate demand is distributed between firms. Now, if the firms have each of their demands, then they calculate their profit level, and what they need to raise from the profits that they have above or below the investment that they want to make determines the change in their debt position with the bank. And similarly, for the households, their change in wealth is the consumption, is the savings, is the income that they have minus the consumption. That's the savings of the households. So I'm just keeping track in the stock flow consistent tradition of all the possible. You see there are real transactions and there's a financial transaction. Keeping track of all of them. So this was done by Carvalho and de Guilmy. Their model is slightly different than the version I presented, but I'm doing here the picture in their paper where they show the agent-based model and the master equation. In my slides, it's going to be called MF, not ME, because we're calling it the mean field approximation, not the master equation approximation. But never mind. And they track each other relatively well. But that's what they found. Now, what could be our contribution? So, okay, if you can have a homogeneous household and two firms, you could as well have the mirror model where you have one firm and two households. That would be easy. But can you have kind of two by two by two by two by two model, where for each sector that you look, you have two different classes. And it turns out that you can, and at no price in complexity of the model. Because what happens is that you now have just this sort of pairs of occupation numbers, and they're decoupled. As long as you don't have that sort of global factor that I mentioned before. So in the follow-up paper, we're going to see how these equations do get couple systems of differential equations. But in this situation where the agents are independent, both within the classes and firms are independent of households, then everything decouples. And now instead of solving one differential equation, you solve two. Instead of solving one Fokker-Planck equation, you solve two. It doesn't work if you have k types in a class. Because now you're essentially going to have one big differential equation with this sort of k minus one states. So things now become more complicated. But there are other methods. After all, people do solve master equations for these general cases. But you need to do a bit more work, and we'll investigate that later. But now the point is that you can easily do a two-by-two case, so two types of firms and two types of households. So the firms behave in the way that I described before. And the difference now here is that the two types of households are workers and investors, or to be more precise, non-investors and investors, because everybody in this model is going to be earning some wages. So even investors will earn wages. But the point is that not all households go to the stock market. Not all households own parts of the productive sector. So you divide them into these two classes. And not only they get divided by in which assets they invest, they also have different propensities. And this also comes out from the data that the poorer fraction of the population spends more as a fraction of the income than the richer households. And also they from the little wealth that they have, which now is only invested in the banking sector, only deposits, they will spend a substantial chunk of that. Whereas investors, they have both a larger income and, well, we'll see arising from the model, a larger income and a larger wealth accumulated in financial assets, and they spend proportionally less. So now, because these things are different, it will matter for aggregate demand who is spending. And this is the point that economists like to make, that if you're going to have a stimulus package, it's more effective if you have some, for example, a program that will increase the grants for all the postdocs in the United States, because they have nothing else. And they're going to use that grant, and they're going to be spending, and that's going to give you a boost of demand. Conversely, it's very ineffective to give tax breaks to billionaires, because they're not going to be spending that anyways, not in their consumption, not in their firms. So that distribution of propensities is important, and we're going to see in the model how does it play a role in aggregate economic activity. So very well. The one thing that gets to be added to the model is the interaction between firms and households. It's done through the stock market, so if firms now have, remember, as I told you before, if they want to invest more than they retain profits, they need to raise money externally. So if they only have the banking sector to raise money, they're going to issue loans. They're going to ask for loans in the banking sector. Now, if they have a stock market, then they can have a proportion of the funds that they need to raise from loans, and a proportion raised from equity. And for now, we are assuming that proportion is constant. It doesn't change very much in time, really, if you look at the data. But you can, yes? Oh, 5 minutes. Yeah, that's right. I cannot conquer the world, but I can do a lot in 5 minutes. This proportion doesn't change much in time, but it could be state dependent. We could have a situation where this proportion depends on the perceived expensiveness of stocks, and that has to do with something called Tobin's Q, is how much the equity market is overvalued or undervalued in comparison with the capital of the firms that are trying to raise stock. But for here, the simpler version of the model, we're going to assume constant proportions, and we're also going to assume that the households, the investor households, are going to invest a constant fraction of their wealth in the stock market. Again, you can have all sorts of microeconomic justifications for that, optimizing utility of consumption over an infinite time, what have you. We're going to take it as an empirical constant that they're going to invest 20% of their wealth in the stock market, 80% of their wealth in the banking sector, or something like that. And then now you have the supply of stocks and then the demand for stocks, and then you solve that for equilibrium, and you have an equilibrium stock price. Macroeconomic stock price. I'm not talking about individual shares. I'm talking about, you know, the total amount of shares that are issued and sort of the aggregate index value of those shares. So here are some simulations for the classes of firms, so aggressive and conservative firms. So the solid lines, blue and red, are the true agent Bayes model simulation. The dotted lines are the mean field approximation. So, of course, for the true agent-based model, you need to simulate one equation for each agent. It's a very computation-intensive model. For the mean field approximation, it's just the one differential equation that I mentioned. This is for household types. So, again, for the investors and non-investors, as a function of the proportion of investors and non-investors, and calculated as an agent base or calculated as a mean field approximation. So that's just to show that at least, you know, you can run more tests to see how well they match each other, but visually, you know, they're kind of satisfactory. And you can look at the, for example, the equity price, the equilibrium equity price that is generated by the agent base model or generated by the mean field approximation of the model. Once we are satisfied that the models produce similar results, then we can concentrate on one class only. I would like to do just the mean field, but the first runs that we had with that was the agent-based model. So what I'm going to show you is the agent-based simulation results for different configurations of agents. And I mean, why would I like to talk about the mean field? Because that's where you can do some analytics. You can look at the steady state. You can look at, you know, what is the expected impact of changes in the composition of these two classes on other variables of the model, and you can do that semi-analytically using the steady-state distribution that you have for the shocks. Whereas for the agent-based model, you have to press the button and wait for the result. But that's the result that I'm going to show you is the true agent-based model, not the approximation. So here is the example one. What is going to change between the two examples is not the proportion of firms and households in each class, but the volatility. So remember that the proportion, if you have lambda going one way and mu going the other way, the proportion is lambda over lambda plus mu. So I'm going to keep that the same, but the volatility is lambda times mu divided by lambda plus mu squared. So I can have the same average and more volatility. And that's what I'm going to do. But I'm not going to make both of them more volatile at the same time. In the example one, households are going to be with low volatility. You can see here there's some path for the number of households with low volatility. And the firms will have high volatility. And in example two, it's going to be the opposite. And everything else is going to be the same. So this is households for the example one, their proportions. Here are the firms' proportions in example one. You see it's more volatile. What you can calculate once you know the class that they belong, you can run the model and see where they end up in terms of financial position. So you can see if they end up with high income or low income. And for firms, if they end up being Minsky classified as a speculative hedge or Ponzi firm. So hedge firms, they have very good financial position. They only they can pay most of their debt with their profits. Speculative firms, they need to they only pay the interest, but they cannot reduce the amount outstanding in debt. And Ponzi, as the name indicates, even to pay the interest, they need to increase the debt. So we can look, but this is not what the classes are to begin with. The firms are only aggressive or conservative. And you can see, depending on what the rest of the economy is doing, what that end up resulting for you. You are aggressive, you might end up Ponzi, but you're aggressive and you might end up hedged. So that's a post calculation. So there's the, but before that, that's the equity price dynamics for this example. And you can see it's kind of a decent increase. Each period here is a quarter, so this is about 100 years. So think of the S&P 500 in 100 years, and you know we adjusted this. This gives about 4% increase. This is what household income is doing. So there's a lot of households that have low income and few households that have high income. I think my threshold is 80 to 20%. Low income is if you're in the 80th percentile of the distribution, and high income, the 20th percentile. And the financial firms, you know, there's some period where they are adjusting what they're doing, but eventually they settle in a situation where there's a proportion of the firms that are speculative and a constant proportion of the firms that are hedge finance. Now we're going to change to example two. Now households are more volatile and firms are less volatile. That's the firms. You know, you still have this more or less same distribution, but you see less volatility. I mean, the same means, but less volatility. Now, here's the equity price. It's a rotten equity price. So over 100 years, it did nothing. It didn't increase by anything. And again, you know, the propensities and savings and this and, you know, retained profits, everything is the same. The only thing that I'm changing is the sort of transition between one type of household to another type of household. This is what the income does, so there's more volatility in their income. And the interesting thing is that now, because of more volatility in the consumption and investment decisions of the households, the firm sector gets affected a lot. So remember, before, we had sort of a convergence financial position for the firms. Now they don't converge to anything. And moreover, there's a significant proportion of the firms who are now in a Ponzi type of situation. And if we refine the model and run more experiments, eventually we want to confirm one of Minsky's you know, fundamental insights, that the number of Ponzi agents in the economy is a very good predictor for financial distress. So of course, financial distress, but that gets reflected in the stock market. So here we have a situation with more Ponzi people and a stock market that is really, really a bad place to invest money. And I'm done. Concluding remarks, you know, I think macroeconomics diverge into two almost incompatible paths since the invention of macroeconomics. One of them has the appearance of being very mathematical by doing, you know, equilibrium analysis, but it has a very poor fit to data and no role for finance, or a very negligible role for finance. The other, it's more grounded on institutions, more grounded on data. There's a very large scope for the role of finance, and I think that's the one that we should all be interested in, but I let you make the choice of what you want.
So as you know, we keep the questions for the end of the whole session. So Julien, so it's going to present some work on how to use vanilla options to find refinements on the lower bounds on the VIX. Thank you.
Okay, is it loud? Yeah. Good morning, everyone. First, I would like to thank Jorge and Bruno and Marco for the kind invitation. It's very good to be back here. And one of the best things this year, I think, is that now I can tell people without lying that I participated in Rio 2016. And there's a decent chance that they believe that I'm an Olympic athlete, and maybe I will let them believe that. So I like the idea. So it's going to be kind of a continuation of Marco's talk, because it's going to be really focusing on VIX futures and their links with S&P options. This is joint work with my colleague Romain Ménégo at Bloomberg and Marcel Nutz from Columbia University. From the outset, I'll tell you that if you want all the details, you can look at the paper that was posted on SSRN 2 months ago. So our objective is to derive sharp bounds for VIX futures given the full information on S&P SMILES, and not only derive the bounds, but also the corresponding sub-replicating or super-replicating portfolios, and to test our results on market data, so see if our results improve the classical bounds. I will also explain how we can characterize the market smiles for which the classical bounds are actually sharp, optimal. And I will probably not have time to study like the specific families of smiles for which we have actually explicit results, in particular situations where the classical bounds are not sharp. So this is another reminder on the VIX. after the one that Marco gave. So the VIX, the volatility index, it's published every 15 seconds by the CBOE. And it is used as an indicator of short-term options implied volatility. So by definition, the VIX is the implied volatility of a 30-day variant swap on the S&P 500. And so equivalency, so when you use the well-known link between realized variance and log contracts, the VIX at a given date, say T1, is simply the implied volatility of the log contracts that will deliver at time T2, which is T1 plus 30 days. So tau will denote 30 days in my talk. So stated otherwise, the VIX is the implied volatility of just the log contracts. Okay, so in this notation here, so V is the VIX at a given date T1. Okay, S1 is the S&P at that same date T1, and S2 is the value of the S&P at T2, which is T1 plus 30 days. Okay, so of course this is not the legal definition of the VIX. Marco recalled that the legal definition uses a finite number of strikes to replicate the log contract, because of course the log contract is not directly quoted on the exchange. You have to replicate the log by using out the money call and put options on the S&P. You see that just here for simplicity, I assume zero interest rates, repo, and dividends. But of course, I mean, you cannot trade the VIX. Okay, the VIX is just an index, and what you can trade is the VIX futures or VIX ETNs or VIX options. Okay, so what is the VIX future? So expiring at a later date T1, it's the financial derivative that pays you the VIX that will be observed at T1, and it pays you that at T1. Okay, so you are at time zero, and you will receive the value of the VIX at a later date T1. Okay. So remember that the VIX squared, okay, it can be replicated using the vanilla options on the S&P. Okay, when you are at time T1, you observe the prices of vanilla options on the S&P. Okay, so you can infer the price of this log contract, hence V squared. So the price of V squared, knowing the S&P smile, is perfectly known. Okay. But the thing is that the VIX is not the VIX squared. It's the square root of this. Okay? So you cannot replicate exactly the VIX. Okay? The payoff of the VIX future when you only trade in vanilla options. Okay? So instead, what we will do, we will take the approach of sub-replication or super-replication. And this will lead us to a model-free bounds on the VIX future. Okay, so to explain where our work fits in the literature, so there has been a lot of work on options on realized variance as opposed to options on implied variance. Okay. So a typical example of options on realized variance, it's call and put on realized variance itself. So it's actually a path-dependent option, very path-dependent, on the asset itself. On the S&P, for instance, okay? And the model-free bounds are deeply linked to the Skowhegard embedding problem. This is, by the way, not specific to variance. Actually, the seminal paper by David Hobson was about model-free bounds for look-back options. And here is like a few selected references. So. Using power payoffs, Peter Carr and Roger Lee in 2003 showed that if you assume that the returns and the instantaneous volatility are driven by independent Brownian motions, then the knowledge of the smile at a given maturity cap T completely determines the law of the realized variance and allows to perfectly replicate the realized variance. But of course, this assumption is first not realistic and very strong. So Bruno derived lower bounds for the prices of calls on realized variance used in like a few years later, 2005, using business time hedging. And his ideas were later extended by Peter Carr and Roger Lee again to deal with the case of puts, okay, on realized variance, and also calls and puts on forward starting realized variance. And more recently, Cox and Wong have actually derived the optimal lower bound for those calls on unrealized variance. Our work fits in the right column, so it's about options and implied variance. And examples are the VIX future, actually, because it's the square root of the VIX squared, which is something that you directly read from implied variance or call or and puts on the VIX. So you see here, it's completely different because you will pay at time T1 something that just you observe at T1 and which depends on the prices of listed options that you observe at T1. Okay, so it's actually just a vanilla option, not at all on the S&P, but on prices of vanilla options on the S&P. Okay, so it's very different in nature. And the model free bounds, the derivation of them are really linked to martingale optimal transport, as we will see. And this line of research was initiated by Stefano De Marco, who's here, and Pierre-Henri Labordère, very recently, last year. So they focused on model free bounds for calls and puts on VIX, okay, VIX options, given the smile of the S&P and the VIX future. So compared to their work, we actually take a step back, and we will look at model free bounds for VIX futures themselves, given the S&P smiles. So just a little bit of notations and very mild assumptions, you'll see. So I will denote by mu1 and mu2 the risk neutral distribution of the S&P at time T1 and time T2. Okay, I assume no butterfly arbitrage. You remember that we have this minus 2 over tau log. Okay, I just don't want to write minus 2 over tau all the time, so I will call capital L this function with the minus 2 over tau factor. So because it's negative, you see that this L function is now decreasing and convex, okay? But I will still say log, okay? I will say log, but it's for this L function, which is negative log, okay? So the important thing is that by the very definition of the VIX squared is the price of this L function, okay, at time T1. And the very mild assumption that we make, it's only that, the price of S1 and S2 at today is just the current value of the S&P, okay? And that we have finite prices for the log contracts. Okay? And then remember that, so the VIX squared here at time T1 is just the price at T1 of this log payoff. So if you want the price at time zero of the VIX squared, is just the price at time zero of something that is worth the price at time T1 of this payoff. So it's just the price at time T0 of this payoff, okay? And I denote it by sigma 1, 2 squared. So if you want sigma 1, 2, it's just the implied volatility at time zero of a forward starting log contract. And you see that this is perfectly known when you know mu1 and mu2, which are the risk neutral distribution at T1 and T2. So first of all, on the classical superapplication of VIX futures, okay? So remember, we can exactly replicate the VIX squared. So if you include zero coupon bonds, you can also exactly replicate A plus B times VIX squared, okay? So here is a graph where on the x-axis, you have the VIX squared, okay? So the orange lines correspond to those portfolios A plus B times VIX squared, okay? That you can replicate exactly at time zero by trading in log contract maturity T2, short log contract maturity T1. And so the purple line is just a square root, so that's the payoff of the VIX future. Okay. So of course, any orange line that is above the purple line is a super replicating portfolio, and you know exactly its price. Okay. So because of the concavity of the square root, of course, you only need to consider the tangent lines. And so they are, if you want, determined by the x-coordinate of the contact points. And now you look at the price of the orange portfolio corresponding to this x-coordinate, and you see that it reaches a minimum precisely when the VIX squared is equal to sigma 1, 2 squared. Okay? And actually, the corresponding price is just sigma 1, 2, this implied volatility of the forward starting log contract. So sigma 1, 2 is a an upper bound for the price of the VIX future. Okay. But it might be not optimal because here we only considered a subfamily of portfolios. If you do the same thing for the sub-replication, so you want a straight line that is always below the square root, and so you end up with just zero. Okay? So the classical lower bound is zero, which is completely useless. Okay? So we will see how we can improve that. So as I mentioned, we don't have to only consider those particular specific super-replicating or sub-replicating portfolios. And actually, so the general formulation of the problem is actually a linear programming problem. Okay. And this is following the work by Stefano and Pierre-Henri Labrador. So what are the financial instruments that are available to us? So at time zero, we have all the vanilla payoffs maturity T1 and all the vanilla payoffs maturity T2. Okay? And the cost of it is just given by the price that you observe in the market that can be written as those expectations, but it's just, there's no model here, it's just the market prices that you observe. But on top of that, when you arrive at time T1, what you can do is to hedge yourself first in the S&P. Okay, so you can buy a quantity of S&P at time T1 and sell it back at time T2. And the quantity here, because it's at time T1, and at time T1 you know the S&P at T1 and you also know the value of the VIX at T1, it can depend on S1 and V. Okay? So the delta can be a function of S1 and V. But you also know at time T1 the value of the lock contract, because you know the VIX. You're at time T1, so you observe the VIX on the market. Okay? So you know that if you enter one lock contract at time T1, it will cost you V squared. Okay? So if you want, of course, the quantity of the lock contract you can enter in can also depend on S1 and V, because those are known quantities at time T1. Okay? And so actually you can generate a payoff that comes from vanilla options maturity T1, vanilla options maturity T2, and those two delta hedges. Okay, and of course, the cost of the delta hedges is zero by construction. Okay. So in the end, you are interested in the cheapest super-replicating portfolio. Okay, so super-replicating portfolio is B1, such that this wealth that you can generate on the left-hand side is greater than V, the VIX, okay, that you want to super-replicate. And you're interested in the cheapest super-replication portfolio. Of course, if you're interested in sub-replication, you will be interested in the most expensive sub-replicating portfolio. Okay. What's interesting and important is to say that this is simply a linear programming problem. Okay. Not so easy to deal with numerically, because you have an infinity of parameters, so all the payoffs U1 and U2, and also an infinity of constraints, because you have to check these constraints for all possible values of S1, S2, and V. Marco has a question. Can you? Is T1 plus 30 days, exactly, yeah. So T1 is the expiration of the future, the VIX future, and T2 is simply T1 plus 30 days. Okay, so if you look at the classical sub or super replication, you see that it actually corresponds to simply taking zero delta on the spot, a constant delta of the lock contract. So the quantity of lock contracts does not depend on the value of the S&P at time T1 and the VIX that you observe. And if you look at this line, that is the wealth of your super-replicating portfolio, okay, now delta S is zero. Delta L is a constant, okay, it's just this minus A. So if you want to cancel the dependency on S1 and S2 here, you have to take U1 to be something like minus the log and U2 to be plus the log. And then it cancels the dependency on S1 and S2, and you're left with just A times V squared plus B, which was those orange lines, okay? And then you just optimize over the parameters A and B, and you recover the classical case. But there is no reason why you should only consider this subfamily, okay, of portfolios. Okay, and if you implement the LP solver for here, those two risk-neutral densities, you get actually this optimal vanilla payoff maturity T1, which is not the log, clearly. This is the vanilla payoff maturity T2. This is the corresponding delta on the spot as a function of S1 and V that you observe at time T1. And same thing for the delta on the log. Of course, I have to consider possibly all functions of S1 and V. So numerically, I cannot do that. And so I've used a polynomial basis of functions. So here, by the way, it was for the sub-replication, that the result that I showed you for sub-replication. Marco has another question. Yeah, it's hard to tell. I will give you like a partial answer when I get to the second part of my talk, where I suggest like using. Marco's question was about like, is there a clear interpretation between the shape of this U1 and U2, okay, and the fact that it's super replicating the VX, no? I don't know. Okay. So because this looks like a strangle, okay. This is just for me the result of the numerical implementation of my LP, and I didn't really like looked into why in this particular case it had this shape. But again, when I introduce like functionally generated portfolios, you will get more insight about the U1 and U2. So this is, okay, the square root, okay, and in orange, it's the value of your portfolio, okay, as a function of S1, S2, and V. Here, it's actually just as a function of V squared for two given values of S1 and S2, and you see that it's indeed sub-replicating. For other values of S1 and S2, it would be even more below the square root function. Here, I just picked precisely the S1 and S2 such that you see that you have a tangent point. And here is the difference between the square root and your sub-replicating portfolio. So it always has to be negative, and that's something that we observe here. So here now, as a function of S1 and S2 for a given value of V. Because it's something that depends on three variables, so you have to pick some variables fixed in the visualization. So we get actually a lower bound of 7.2%, which is much larger than zero, okay, which is the classical lower bound. But we observe that actually the upper bound is equal to the classical one, and here in that case, 22.8%. Okay. So there's here a big practical problem. So how can I try all the payoffs U1, U2, and all the delta functions, okay, delta S, delta L. Numerically, it's very difficult. Okay? We have to check the sub and super replication constraints everywhere. Actually, here, I show just a graph for another value of V, which is, by the way, even not beyond the bounds of my discrete LP problem, but just in between two grids of V. And actually, for some values of S1 and S2, here you don't see, it's actually slightly positive. So, okay, I cannot guarantee numerically that my payoff is strictly speaking sub-replicating. So, I now want like get more tractability, okay, at the expense of flexibility. This is LP solver, it's very flexible but not tractable. And now I will introduce like an intermediate solution that is very tractable. But not totally flexible, because we will only consider now a family, okay, of sub or super replicating portfolio, but a family that is much richer than the classical one. Okay. So how does it work? So I actually claim that this family of portfolio will be completely determined by a convex function or concave for sub replication. So here it's for the case of super replication. You take phi, a convex function of two variables, okay, which basically are going to be the spot and the log, okay, and you will consider this vanilla payoff maturity T2, which is precisely phi of the spot comma, it's log. Okay? And then you easily define the deltas on the spot and the log contract by just being the negative, okay, of the first order derivatives of the phi function. Of course, you cannot take them at S2, L of S2, because it's, I mean, it's not known at time T1. So you take them at S1, which is known, and log of S1 plus V squared. Okay. And same for delta L. Okay. And then you define the payoff in the end at maturity, vanilla payoff maturity T1 as being the smallest function such that U1 plus phi of S1, L of S1 plus V squared is greater than V. Well, I claim that this portfolio always super-replicate the VIX. Okay. And the proof is actually super easy. So of course, if you want to compute this smallest U1, you just have to, okay, U1 has to be greater than V minus phi, blah, 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 for all V. So you just take for this phi star, the which is U1, the supremum over V of this difference. And the proof is super simple, so I cannot resist doing the proof here. So because phi is convex, so it's above, okay, all the tangent hyperplanes, okay, so which is exactly this inequality here, okay, between phi S2 L of S2 and phi of S1 L of S1 plus V squared. Okay. So now if you look at the wealth of my portfolio, okay, I replace U2 by phi of S2 L of S2, the deltas by the negative of the first order derivatives here. And you see that this red term, just because of the convex inequality, okay, it's actually greater than phi of S1, L of S1 plus V squared. Okay? So if I add U1 to this, I get this. And precisely because I'm picking U1, which is the smallest, such that this U1 plus phi is greater than V, that's done. Okay? So I'm super replicating the VIX. So the interpretation at time T1 is the following. So remember, this is just the convex inequality. You see that this is actually the payoff from delta hedging on the S&P. This is the result of delta hedging on the log contract. So the right-hand side here has price zero at time T1. So here, the left-hand side, which is greater than this, so it has positive price at time T1. So that means that at time T1, you can actually super replicate phi of S1, log of S1 plus V squared by trading in vanilla options maturity T2 with this payoff. Okay? And of course, if you can replicate phi of S1, L of S1 plus V squared, you can also add U1. Okay? So you can super replicate this. And you just choose U1 and phi such that this is greater than V at T1. So you are actually linking the prices of vanilla options, S1, S2, T1, T2, and V squared with such a convex inequality. And the classical super application portfolio corresponds to, again, here, one particular choice where this function phi, okay, of spot and log actually only depends on the log, and it's a constant times the log. Okay? And if you do that, okay, you see that the delta is zero, delta L, so you exactly recover the classical case, and actually the proposition tells you that in order to build analytical super-replicating portfolios. So instead of considering a payoff U2 which is just linear in the log, you should actually generally consider convex function of the spot and the log. That's the message of this proposition. If you're interested in sub-replication, you replace convex by concave. So here is a small illustration and animation. So this is the orange curve is for, so here it's for sub-replication that I showed you. So of phi of, some given phi of S1, L of S1 plus V squared. Okay, and you see, so this is of course the square root. And for, this is as a function, okay, the x-axis is again the VIX squared. So this is for a given value of S1. And you have to find, okay, value depending on S1 such that for all V squared, it's below the square root, okay? And that's this U1 function that's the same for everyone. So now we have a portfolio family that is, okay, parameterized by a convex or concave function, but it's convex or concrete function in dimension 2, okay, with two variables. And that's problematic because we don't know how to test all concave or convex functions in dimension 2. Okay, we know that in dimension 1, the extremal rays of the convex cone of convex functions are the call and put payoffs. Okay, but we don't have the same result in dimension 2 or more. And actually, we even have a result which is quite negative, which is the fact that the extreme rays in dimension 2 or more are actually dense in the cone. So you have too many test functions. Okay, so. And so our workaround is actually to consider only convex or concave, concave functions of the type psi of ax plus y, so a times the spot plus the log, where psi is convex or concave, but just in dimension 1. So psi we can just decompose on call and put payoffs. And then we optimize on a and the psi. And this is what we get for sub-replicating portfolio, where psi is just a concave polygonal line, and we optimize on it. So you see for different values of S1, okay, the result of the sub-replication. Same, but with now a cut square root. So okay, what we didn't like here is basically the fact that it's flat, because it's just like piecewise affine, of course, it can only have a non-positive slope, okay, to the right. Otherwise, it will pass the square root function. So we try this cut square root. We cannot use a square root because otherwise, here because of the infinite slope of the square root, it would behave badly here, and I would get bad optimal results on this side here. But the cut square root actually gives very good results. And on this case of rich neutral densities that I got using the Sabre formula, these are the payoffs U1 and U2 that we get in the case of the polygonal line, the ones that we get in the case of the cut square root, and the numerical results. Okay, so remember that the LP solver gave us 7.2 for the lower bounds in the case of those smiles. So here, of course, it's not as good, but those ones here are guaranteed to be sub-replicating portfolios everywhere. Okay. So that's the benefit. We did the same, actually, on market smiles, and also observed that the classical upper bound is actually numerically optimal. But of course, the classical lower bound, which is 0, is far from being optimal. Typically, you get something like around 8%. Okay? So there is still a lot of room between 8% and 16%, which is not surprising, if you want, because VX is about the conditional distribution of S2 given S1, if you want. So if you have just the rich neutral distribution of S1 and the rich neutral distribution of S2, that does not tell you much about the joint distribution. So that's why you have like quite a lot of room between, a lower bound and the upper bound, but still, I mean, it's much better than the classical lower bound. And one interesting question is that we observe, at least numerically, that actually the optimal, the classical upper bound, like seems to be optimal. Okay, and so we wonder whether we could characterize the market smiles actually, for which indeed we can say from when you show me the smiles. And I can tell you, okay, in this case, the classical bound is actually optimal. And this is what will lead us to optimal transport. So I recall briefly the set of martingale measure, which is like something that I will use in the proof. So we're considering now measures, okay, on S1, S2, S1 spot at T1, S2 spot at T2, okay, with given marginals mu1 and mu2, which are given by the market, okay, and we are considering only the martingale measures because we know that the price at T1 of S2 has to be S1, okay, so this is the set M of martingale measures. So that actually corresponds to somehow. So you see that here there's no VIX model. So the price at T1 of the log contract, okay, in this model, will simply be the conditional expectation of L of S2 over S1 given S1. It corresponds to the case where the VIX is just a function of S1. Okay. So see that just because of the convexity of L, okay, the price is indeed always positive and has expectation sigma 1, 2 squared. So why is it interesting, like this set of, and where does it naturally arise? It's when you want to super replicate a payoff, say, of S1 and S2, okay? So payoff depending on the S&P at time T1 and the S&P at time T2. So no VIX here, okay? Purely S&P options. So if you mimic, okay, the reasoning that I explained with the linear programming, you see that you will consider super replicating portfolios of this type, where you can delta hedge at time T1. Again, there is no VIX involved here. And you're interested in the cheapest super replication price. And actually, this cheapest replication price, I call here P super, P is for primal, is actually most of the time equal to another quantity, which is called the dual, and which is the supremum over all martingale measures of the risk neutral expectation of the payoff. Okay. So you always have that the dual is less than the primal. That's the weak Monge-Kantorovich duality. And actually, most of the time, you have, under very mild assumptions, you have the equality of dual and primal problems. So when now you include the VIX, okay, but you do exactly the same, and you see that actually the set that naturally arises is another set that I call MV. And that's very natural. It's the set of probability distribution on S1, S2, and V. Okay, so now it's probability on a random variable, if you want, in dimension 3, S1, S2, and V. And you want S1 to have the correct risk-neutral distribution, S2 as well. You want the price of S2 at time T1 to be S1, but now at time T1, you know S1 and V. And you want the price of the log contract at time T1 to be V squared, by the very definition of the VIX. So that's this set of probability distribution MV. And that corresponds to the case where the VIX is not necessarily a function of S1. Okay, it has its own randomness. Of course, when we project V squared onto the just the function of S1, we must recover the case where the VIX is a function of S1. So this is the lambda mu of S1. So lambda mu was just here the price, okay, of the log contract in my simple model with just S1 and S2 at the variable. And we always have that the price of V squared at time zero is always this sigma 1, 2 squared for all those models here. So we have this nice result, which is the absence of a duality gap. And by the way, it's not about VIX futures or sub or super replication. Okay? It's for any payoff that satisfies this upper semi-continuity assumption and the growth assumption here. So it's also valid for VIX options, for instance. Okay. And it tells you basically that the dual problem is equal to the primal problem. Okay. This is, on the contrary, like a result that is very specific to super replication of VIX futures. So it's not valid for sub-replication, and it's not valid for things other than VIX futures. And it basically tells you that a dual optimal measure can always be chosen of the local volatility type. Okay, so when V is a function of S1. Okay, you don't have to look to the case where V could have its own source of randomness. I skipped the proof. And before telling you about when is the classical bound optimal, we have still to precise a bit what we mean actually by arbitrage. Okay. Because if you don't have the VIX, okay, typically an arbitrage is going to be a portfolio like this that super replicates zero but has a negative price. Okay. So now when you introduce the VIX, you're going to do the same. Okay. But now you have delta S that may depend on S1 and V, and you also have the possibility to delta hedge in the log contract, and you use the same definition. So it's clear that if you have an S arbitrage, okay, then you can build an SV arbitrage. Okay? So absence of SV arbitrage implies absence of S arbitrage. But actually, it turns out that the two notions are equivalent, which is not so surprising because we are not giving information on the prices of options on V. Yet the proof uses the difficult direction of Strassen's theorem that basically tells you that if you have two distributions in convex order, then there exists a martingale measure consistent with those two measures. And so the main result here of this section that I want to tell you and will conclude soon is about the case, okay, where can we characterize the cases where the classical bound is actually optimal. For this, I will just use the short notation L1 and L2 for the expectation of the log contract, maturity T1, maturity T2, so that sigma 1 2 square is actually just the difference of L2 and L1. And I will just denote by M bar, so the set of martingale measures. So remember, this is the martingale measures just on S1, S2, such that not only the price of the VIX is a function of S1, but it's actually constant. It actually does not depend on S1, it's just a constant. And because the price is sigma 1 2 squared, that in that case, this constant can only be sigma 1 2 squared. And then the theorem reads as follows. So the classical, so this is the classical upper bound, okay? It is equal to actually the optimal upper bound if and only if there exists a model on S1, S2, and V such that V is almost surely constant, okay? It's also equivalent to the fact that this set M bar is non-empty. And from this characterization, we can go to this one, which is very interesting, which is more handy, which tells you that actually, so the classical is optimal if and only if two distributions in dimension 2 are in convex orders. And those distributions are distribution of S1 and its log recentered at time T1, and same at time T2. Okay, so you have two distributions in dimension 2, and you have to check that they're in convex order, and it's necessary and sufficient condition for the optimal, the classical bound to be optimal. And this is not so surprising because you remember the square root shape. So of course, if you have variance on V, then the price can only get lower than the classical bound sigma 1, 2. So it's quite clear that the classical is optimal if there is a model that is consistent with mu 1, mu 2, and all the constraints such that V is a constant. And when you project on the first two coordinates, you get this second result. And the proof, I don't do it, but it's very simple. It's actually the application of Strathairn's theorem, but just in dimension 2. So the thing is that again, you see, you have to check that two distributions in dimension 2 are in convex order. So you have to, that involves convex function in dimension 2, and you don't know how to test on all convex functions in dimension 2, not like in dimension 1. So if you only look at just the second component here, so you don't look at the, so you, if you know that the law of just the second components are not in convex order, of course the law of the joint distribution are not in convex order, and that tells you that the classical is not optimal. And that's exactly what this proposition tells you, and that only involves the prices of call and put options. So that's nice, that's a very general one. And yeah, so this is on the sub-replication side, it's very easy that, to see that actually the classical, which is does zero, is optimal if and only if the two risk neutral distribution at T1 and T2 coincide, which is never the case. So that's why we see. And I will just show one slide of this just to let you know that we have examples of market smiles for which the optimal super application is actually smaller, strictly smaller than the classical one. Okay, so you can really improve the classical super replication. And okay, so this is in the totally unrealistic case where mu 2 is just a Bernoulli distribution. So that's a link with the implied volts that Bruno showed with the two Dirac masses. Okay, so typically in that case, you always improve the classical one. This is actually more general because this is when you assume that mu 2 has compact support. So just depending on how you extrapolate your smile, you can always somehow decide that your risk neutral distribution has compact support. And in that case, you indeed improve the classical bound only if mu 1, so the risk neutral distribution at T1, puts weights close to the edges of the support of mu 2 at time T2. And when the smile at T2 corresponds actually to a three-point distribution, there is a very graphical condition. So I will skip this. I will be glad to send the the slides by email for those who want them. So this is, for instance, the U1 and U2 for the binomial case. The graphical illustration of the fact that the support of mu1 must be close to the support of mu2 to the right. Anyway, and that's the very nice graphical condition when mu2 is a three-point distribution. This is detailed in the graph. So I'm concluding by telling you, just presenting a bit differently what I just told, as an attempt to bring a very partial answer to a long-standing and important question in volatility markets, which is what information on the dynamics of the implied volatility surface is included in the volatility surface itself at time zero. Okay? Or stated otherwise, how is the surface dynamics constrained by the current state of the surface? Or stated again otherwise, what information on volatility of volatility is contained in the surface of implied vol itself? Or what information on the prices of volatility derivative, if you want. And we gave a very partial answer. So first, our contribution is not given the whole implied volatility surface, but just given two slices at T1 and T2, so two slices. We are not considering like all volatility derivatives, but just one, which is the VIX future. And what we have shown is that the price of the VIX future, okay, is constrained. So that means that the standard deviation of the VIX is constrained. So of course, it's part of it was already well known. So you know the square root is concave, okay, and the standard deviation cannot go negative, okay. So it's clear that the price of the VIX future cannot go as far as you want. So that's the classical upper bound. But actually, we have shown as well that the standard deviation of the VIX cannot be too large either. A very large standard deviation of the VIX would somehow give a zero price for the square root of the VIX square, okay, if you want for the VIX future. And that's not the case. We went from like somehow a band from 0 to 16% to a band from 8 to 16%. So we showed that there are links between, so just the current state of the implied volatility surface tells you that when you arrive at time T1, the VIX squared, which is a function of the surface that you will observe at time T1, is actually constrained. And we derived so sharp bounds and the corresponding portfolios, either using the exact formulation as an LP problem or a new family of functionally generated sub and super replicating portfolios. We have seen that in typical markets, the classical upper bound is actually sharp, meaning that the market is such that it's consistent with the model where the VIX would have zero standard deviation. And we have explicit examples where it's not the case, and also proved like this absence of duality gap. So I would like to thank Bruno, Lorenzo, Stefano, Pierre for comments and valuable feedback. And this is a list of a few selected references that you can look. So here is the, that's the paper by Stefano and Pierre. And I'm done. Thank you very much.
Okay, so as the two sessions were kind of very orthogonal or not negatively correlated, but yeah, so it's a big stretch. So maybe it will be a bit exotic to hear questions from one of the other ones. So anyone in the audience has questions for any of the two speakers? Yes, Temu.
Oh yeah, that's a very good question, of course. So I used MOSEC, you know, the software. So of course you have to discretize, so your parameters are the payoff U1s and U2. Okay, so here it's quite easy. I just like, you know, discretize using like a call and put payoffs. Given strikes. I actually add the log contract to help the solver find the classical solution. Okay. And for the deltas.
So then you only require the super
constraint. Wait. So that's just for the parameter, and then I'll go to the constraints. So first the parameters, the U1, U2, and the deltas, you know, they are functions of S1 and V. I should test all of them. Of course, I cannot, so I take polynomial basis. And then for the constraints, I also have like an infinite number of constraints, and I just check them on a grid, a very large grid. Okay, but that's what I showed, that actually if you have a point, like even not beyond the limits of your grid, but in between two points of your grid, you could actually violate the superreplication constraint, which is why it's interesting to have the family of functionally generated portfolios. Exactly, so that's, if I can just go back to just the numerical results here, it's, you will see that this, yeah, this, for instance, this, I don't know, 8.4%, I cannot strictly guarantee you that it's sub-replicating, that's the price of a portfolio that's sub-replicating everywhere, but my guess, educated guess, is that actually the true answer will be very close to the 8.4, closer to 8.4 than to the 7.8, which are the...
By the way, I would like to actually thank Chris. It seems he has a question as well. But, which is that actually something like 7 years ago when I was looking at a similar problem for super replication, and we had discussed about the primal, the dual, is it better to try numerically to find the cheapest super replicating portfolio or the maximum of the expectation on the Martingale methods calibrated to the market. You suggested the second one with the LP methodology, and which I did and implemented, and it is really, I think, the best method. So thank you for this, Chris. You're entitled to have a question then. Five.
Let me start. And then if you regard that joint distribution as the choice variable, then it becomes an LP problem, doesn't it?
Well, so the thing is that I characterize the distributions on S1, S2, and V such that the classical bound is optimal. And it actually corresponds to those distributions on S1, S2, and V that satisfy, you know, that you have the right marginal at T1, T2, the VIX squared is the expectation of the log, blah, 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 and such that the VIX is constant. So it's actually, I'm just characterizing, so the dual problem is quite clear, so you're actually looking at the sup over all the, if you want, martingale measures, but with the extra constraint of the expectation of the payoff. And actually, there are some cases where actually the result of this is actually the classical bound, which was just using like, you know, A plus B times V squared, so something simple. Yeah. But it actually happens that actually the when you do your best, when you optimize over all this, actually corresponds to the simple case, and that corresponds to those distributions where V is constant. Yeah.
Sure. I mean, that's perhaps not very surprising, but I mean, you know, kind of conceptually.
Yeah. So that was, I missed your point. Yeah, absolutely. From a numerical point of view, I completely agree that, I mean, how would I specify?
So I think I have a question to Matheus, which, because it's slightly a topic which is a bit different. And so you had a graph with, actually, your simulation for the stock price was very highly mean reverting. Which equity price, which means it would seem to be kind of arbitrageable. If you really, you have market doing this, you buy low, sell high. So is that actually arbitrage considerations are not built in into the model?
Well,
there's no model for it to be mean reversion. Mm. The result of that simulation showed up like that. The other one.
I would love to be in that world. I will get rich.
Well, but you would have to learn about that model first, and then be sure that, and then perhaps you start trading.
After having seen this for 5 years, I get an idea.
I think Chris, but
okay.
Back to your talk, Tess, and I mean, is how we're going to do that. And if you've got a model where the method of exploring that model is by simulation, it then becomes very, very difficult to attempt to fit into data because calibration is...
Yeah, but calibration is not the method even for the other type of models, the dynamical systems models. It's estimation. So, it, you know, the, well, it's different because you have the sort of the underlying time series are things like the propensity to save, the investment, and those things you should... The moral of the story is that you estimate them before you put that in the model, and there are no free parameters. Well, you might have free parameters in terms of some of the transition probabilities. You can have some noise in that, and those you calibrate. But then that's, you know, a small set of the parameters in the model. So it's very different from DSGE. In DSGE, you're right. The majority of the parameters are things that you have no direct estimation method, and all that you have is the prediction of the model, and then you calibrate, okay? But that's one methodology, and I think that is a poor methodology, because then you just move to the other month and then you recalibrate and it has nothing to do, as you have it, the calibration hoax. I mean, this is not a criticism of this type of model. Yeah.
I think we take one last question.
Of what, sorry?
When you come up with the idea of Pitta-Merlin, then you have
Perry-Merlin, yeah.
You're in a queue.
Yeah.
And the quantity will contract and come back, and so if you have different behaviors from these two stages, wouldn't it be better to work with these stages instead of making different behaviors for the investors?
Okay, so the question was, shouldn't we model directly the situation? It was referring to that triangle picture that I had for Merlin of, the situation where there is a lot of liquidity in the market, the balance sheets are very large, and then the difference between the types of cash, it's blurred, or a situation where you have a contraction, like high interest rates or something that drains liquidity out, and then you have a very distinct difference between the, and shouldn't we model that instead of modeling the behavior of the agents? Well, you could, except that there was a qualitative picture. It was a, I'm not proposing a model where, liquidity is directly related as a triangle to the types of assets. One could try that. I don't know what the result would be. It's just that, I think even considering that, this is a result of what the agents are doing. So if you want to be a bit more fundamental, then you go to what the agents are doing. The whole game here is try to, model first principles as much as we can, right? Right. That's true, and that's the part that I mentioned. So the question was, how do you incorporate the reaction to some aggregate scenario? And there are many ways to do that, but in this particular class of models, I would have the transition functions depend on the individual transition functions, the number of agents that are in the class, and some aggregate variable. Like I mentioned, the expected gains for transition into a different class. And then you can have the kind of, so we'll introduce correlation between the agents, we'll introduce even correlation between the sectors. And so we can do that. That'll be the next paper.
Okay, so to preserve time for a nice lunch, so we are going to stop here. So let's thank again all the speakers.
Thank you, Bruno, and for chairing the session. Thank you, Julien and Matheus. So just quick announcement. We are going to try to resume at 2:30 p.m. There is the option of eating here at IMPA, and